So I know what some of you might be thinking. This is not working. This is working. Let's keep with the button. Let's talk about the conference. BS are involved. Functional programming. Is this like really reasonable? So I want to start by reassuring you. It's not going to be like.
So it's working now.
Great technology. So it's not going to be like one of these functional programming talks full of like custom operators and functions that return function that return function. We're going to focus on one idea and how it can be applied. So I want to begin by showing you this Swift code. So it's pretty simple Swift code. And I want you to see that it involves two keywords of the Swift language, lazy and var. So I'm pretty sure you're familiar with these keywords. But still, I want to talk about them a little bit because we're going to see that they're quite different. Like var, it's a keyword that lets us allocate a variable. So when you think about it, the only thing that it's doing is that it's allocating memory. So it's a pretty simple behavior. And then there is this other keyword, which is called lazy. And people who've like written Objective-C remember writing by hand lazy loading. And I think you remember that lazy loading is a much more complex behavior because it involves like testing, instantiating a value if it hasn't yet been instantiated, then returning it. So there are two keywords, but they offer like a very different level of abstractions. One is very simple, one is much more involved. But yet still lazy, it's a Swift keyword, so it's part of the language, just as var. And as I said, it encapsulates a complex behavior. And when we use it, we avoid a lot of boilerplate code. If you remember Objective-C, when you had to write lazy loading by hand, it was a lot of boilerplate code, and it was a lot of error-prone code. So lazy is a good addition to the Swift language, and it makes sense to have it be built into the language like this. However, when we think about it, lazy loading, that's definitely not the only useful abstraction for developers. And there are lots of other abstractions that we would like to have built into the language. But as you can guess, like Swift cannot integrate everything into the language because it would be completely like crazy and become useless. So what I want to talk to you today is, how about we try to do it ourselves? How about we try to implement our own pseudo keywords that are going to offer us kind of the same level of ease of use and functionality than a keyword, but it's going to be defined and made by ourselves. So where do we start? We can start by recognizing that Swift really loves functional programming. Swift has been built to work well with functional programming, and I'm going to remind you very quickly of how Swift implements functional programming. So you need to think only of one thing, is that in Swift, functions are first-class citizens. What does this mean? It means three things. First, it means that a function can be stored within a variable, like this. Then it means another thing. It means that a function can take another function as an argument. So I think most of you are familiar with functions like map. We call them higher order functions because they take a function as an argument. And there is a third one that sometimes we are not that familiar with, is that a function can also return a function. Here I have a function, it's called build incrementer, and it returns an incrementer function, so a function that takes an integer and increments it. That's all you need to know about functional programming in Swift in order to follow the content of this talk. So I think we're pretty good. And now we need to think, okay, what do we do with this? How do we build like keywords, pseudo keywords using this? If you use Xcode, you know that there is a tool which is called refactoring. It doesn't always work, but when it does, it allows you to do something that's pretty cool, is that you can select some chunk of your code and you can say, I want to extract this code as a method. So as we know, a method is pretty much the same thing than a function. So when you think about it, we see that we can extract chunks of our code into functions. We can also write functions that take function as argument and return other functions. So maybe we could be able to write functions that will take as an argument a piece of code, will enhance this piece of code with a new functionality, and then return the enhanced version as the return value. So when I say it like this, maybe it's a little bit abstract, so I'm going to go right now into an example in order to make it much more clear and much more concrete to you. So we are going to write a pseudo keyword called delayed. It's going to allow us to delay the execution of a piece of code. So what does it look like? We are writing a function called delayed. It takes an argument, It takes a function that takes no argument and returns void, so just a piece of code that's going to perform some side effects. And we see that this function returns a function of the same type. And what's happening inside is that we are returning a function that's basically going to take the action received as an argument and do like dispatch queue main async after 5 seconds, execute this piece of code. So we are adding a 5 seconds delay to execute the action through the dispatch queue API. And then when we use it in our code, thanks to Swift's writing closure syntax, we can use it like this. We can just put the name of the function. We don't have to put parentheses. Swift can infer the fact that we are calling the function. And then we can put the chunk of code that we want to pass as an argument in a closure right after the name of the function using curly braces. And then we can call the function. And if we were to call it, if we were to run this code on a playground, we would see that 5 seconds after we clicked on run, we would have in the console the text hello world being written. And what I want you to see is that thanks to this trailing closure syntax, the way that we are calling the delayed function makes it look really close like a language keyword would. When you think about it, if you put this in Xcode, the only difference between delayed being a native keyword or not is the fact that it's going to be colored in a different way. But otherwise, it looks very close to a native keyword. If tomorrow Swift decides to add it as a keyword, it would probably look like this. So it's a pretty interesting idea. Now let's see what we can build, if we can build like more useful example with this idea. So we're going to begin with something that's pretty simple, caching. That's something that's very useful in apps. Like if we have functions that perform like heavy computation, we might want to cache the result. If we are calling web services, we might want to also cache the result. So how can we implement caching using this pseudo keywords technique? So we are going to implement a function called cache. So I'm going to walk you step by step through the implementation. So what you can see is that it's a generic function. It takes an input that has to be hashable because we are going to store our values inside a dictionary. And there is a second generic argument, b. It takes as input a function from a to b, and it returns a function from a to b. So there is nothing special in the signature of the function. Within the function, what we are doing, we are declaring a local variable. It's our cache, so it's just a dictionary that associates keys of type A to values of type B. And then we're going to return a function that takes an input of type A and returns something of type B. And inside this function, we're just going to do like a lookup in the cache. We're going to say, okay, if the value that we are being asked to compute for the input has already been computed and is already in the cache, we're just going to retrieve it and return it. Otherwise, we're going to actually run the computation, put the value in the cache, and return the result. So that's what this function looks like. There's nothing extraordinary about it. It's a pretty standard cache. Word of advice, this code does not work with recursive function. But then when we use it, like if imagine that we are doing some kind of 2D or 3D code and we are doing trigonometry, we want to cache the result of trigonometric function because they are expensive function calls. We can build, using the pseudo keyword cached, a cached version of the cost function. So we just declare it by saying let cache cost equals cached and then our function, which is just a call to the cost function. And then we call this function, so we call it to get the cosinus of 2 pi. The first time it takes quite a long time to compute because it's a trigonometry computation. But then the value will be into our cache and the next time that we access it is going to be much faster. And what's really cool is that usually when you try to involve caching in your code, you're going like to decrease the readability of your code because you've added state, you've added implementation details. But here it's pretty transparent. We've just had to add the pseudo keywords cache and the work has been done. So I think that's pretty nice way to implement this kind of behavior. Another example that's very useful is debouncing. So in order to make it like more of a real world problem, I'm going to take a real use case. Imagine that we have a scrollable screen and we want in our analytics to understand how the user is behaving on the screen. For instance, if we have an app like Facebook or Twitter with an infinite feed, maybe we want to know if the user keeps scrolling because it's really hooked into our service. Or if we have like a setting screen, we want to know if like the user is is not finding, is scrolling up, down, because it's a, it could give us the information that our screen doesn't make sense to the user. So it's a valuable information to know how the user is scrolling on the screen. So if you want to implement this in iOS, basically you're going to use the content offset property of a table of the scroll view, and you're going to send its value to an analytics platform. The question that you have to answer is, when should you send it? Because if you do like the naive implementation, you implement your scroll view delegate, you put your type as the delegate of the scroll view, then there is this callback that's going to get called scroll view did scroll. So you get the content offset, you send it to your analytics. But the issue with this is that this method is going to get called like for every single pixel that is scrolled. So you're going to like kill your analytics platform immediately with garbage data. So you don't want to do this. You want to use something that is called debouncing. So debouncing, if we want to give a definition, it's waiting for a given time span to elapse before performing an action. And any new call that's going to be made during that time frame is going to reset the timer. To put it in a very real world thing, it's like you get into an elevator, you press on the button, and someone is running toward the elevator, so you press the button to keep the doors open, the timer has been reset, and it's going to do the same thing every single time someone is coming to the elevator, only when no one is no longer coming is the elevator going to take off. It's the same behavior. So we're going to introduce a pseudo keyword that we're going to call debounced. So this one is going to be a little more involved because it's going to take some arguments. It's going to take a delay, so it's the frame, the time frame that we are giving our debouncing behavior. We're going to give it a default value of 300 milliseconds because usually it's a value that makes sense. We are going also to be able to specify a dispatch queue to do this debouncing. By default, we're going to do it on the main queue. And finally, we're going to take as an argument the action that we are debouncing, and it's just a function from void to void. And we are returning a function from void to void because we are just adding behavior to the action that we took as an argument. Inside the function, we're going to declare a variable which is going to be a dispatch work item. And then we're going to return a function. What we are going to do is, if this work item has already been created, we're going to cancel it. Then we're going to create a new work item. We're going to schedule it to be executed after the delay. And what's going to happen is that the first time that the function is called, the work item is going to be scheduled. And then every single time that it is called before the delay, the work item will be canceled, a new one will be scheduled, and only after the delay has elapsed without any new call will the work item be actually executed. So this is how you implement debouncing. Now we said that we needed to be aware of the content offset, so I'm just added an argument, you see. I used to take a function that didn't take an argument, now I take an argument of type t. It didn't change many things, just instead of just calling the function, I'm just calling it with an argument. Nothing new here. Yeah. I did argument of type t, I take it as an argument. When I create my work item, I call the function using the argument. That's it. And now, if we update the implementation of the scroll view delegate, what we are going to do is that we are going to implement this scroll handler. It's going to be, just like before, a function that sends the content offset of a scroll view to an analytics platform, but we are using our pseudo keywords debounced, which is adding this debouncing behavior. And then within the scroll view scroll method, we just call the handler that we have created. And this way we have implemented a debouncing method. And what's nice is that it's completely encapsulated, like we didn't have to introduce any new variable to the state of our type. And also, it's something that's very clear to read. We have the word debounce, the intent is clear. So it's also nice from a software engineering point of view. So yeah, these two parts of code. So I think that's pretty cool, but I think we shouldn't stop here. We should keep going further. So let's keep up the good work, and let's talk about capturing self-enclosures. So if you written Swift code, you've probably written this kind of code where you take a completion handler and you need to have a reference to self in your completion handler, but you cannot use self, you cannot capture self directly because it would create a return cycle and a memory leak. So what you need to do is that you need to add this weak self at the beginning of the closure to say that you are capturing a weak instance. And then at the very beginning of the closure, you need to guard to make sure that self is still around in memory. So when you write Swift code as a full-time job, you find yourself writing this weak self, guard, self equals self thing a lot of time, and it would be pretty cool if we could like just get rid of it. So the good answer is that we can, and we are going to do it. So, and we're going to see it doesn't take that much of a code. To begin, we're going to implement a protocol. It's going to be called Wickable, and it's going to be constrained to only be implemented by reference types, because anyway, it doesn't make sense to capture a value type. Then we're going to extend NSObject to make it conform to this protocol Wickable. So when we do this, every NSObject instance that's around here, so every Objective-C object conforms to Wickable. And finally, we're going to put some code into Wickable through an extension. And we're going to implement this function, which is called Wickify. So it takes as argument a function that has an instance of type self and returns void. And it returns a function that takes no argument and returns void. And what we are doing inside is that we are going to return a function that captures self, test whether self is still around, and then calls the function that has been put into memory and gives it the self instance. So it might look a little bit weird. When I wrote it the first time, I had like trouble to convince myself that this was working, but we are going to see an example right after. We are going to see that it works. So that was the implementation when you were only interested in capturing self and you don't take an argument, but compression handlers, they often take arguments. So we can add an argument. It's just a generic parameter of type A. We take it as an argument. And we do the same thing that we did before. Just when we call our code, we give it an instance of self and the value of type A. And then if we rework our service call, now we no longer have to write all the weak self thing. We just have to put the pseudo keyword wikify in front of the closure. And in the closure, we say, OK, I'm going to get my strong self reference, because that's what Wickify does. And then I'm going to get the result parameter that my compression handler normally does. And we no longer have to do all the weak self and the guarding. We can use the strong self directly. Basically, we've been able to encapsulate all of this behavior within this Wickify pseudo keyword. So now we are able to get the strong self in a declarative way. We don't have to write all of the boilerplate code. And if you apply this technique in a large code base, you can imagine that you're going to end up like saving yourself a lot of time. But that's not the only thing that you can do with this technique. I'm going to show you a last example, and we're going to focus on asynchronous code. So asynchronous code in Swift, if you do it like using APL APIs, it takes the form of compression handlers. And compression handlers, they are pretty nice because they are easy to use, but they have one big flaw, is that they are hard to compose. When you want to compose two compression handlers together, you end up nesting them one into the other. And what's bad is that it creates this kind of code, which has a name. It's called callback hell. So as you can guess, it's not a good name. It's because this kind of code is very hard to maintain. Imagine that you have like 6-7 services called one after the other, and then someone says, oh, you need to like change the order of these two. You're into a world of trouble. If you are in Swift, it's cool because you have a type-safe compiler. In Objective-C, it used to be worse. But this is not a really nice way to deal with asynchronous code. So there are some solutions. There are things like Promises, Eric Swift, Combine, that Daniel showed this morning. But I want to show you another approach that is used in languages like JavaScript or C#, which is called the async await pattern. So to begin, I'm going to do something that is going to look really stupid, but I want you to bear with me because it's all going to make sense in the end. We are going to take an asynchronous function as a parameter, and we're going to turn it into a synchronous function. So how are we going to implement this? We are just going to use a lock. We are going to create the lock. We're going to call the function. We're going to lock the thread. Wait until the function has returned and the compression handler has been called. And then we are going to unlock and return the result. So we've turned an asynchronous function that doesn't block the thread that called it into a synchronous function that does block the thread that called the function. So you can be thinking, what's the point? I mean, we don't want to block our threads. Asynchronous functions have been made in order not to block threads. Well, what I want you to think is that this function makes sync one. When you think about it, it lets you like extract the asynchronicity out of a function. And we're going to see that this is something that can be leveraged in a very nice way. We are going to define two things to make our code like easier to read. First, we're going to define some global queue. So it's a dispatch queue that is a concurrent queue. And we're going to define this type alias called completion handler of T. It's a type alias of a function that takes an instance of T and returns nothing. So it's just going to make the function signature easier to read for you. And now we're going to define this function that is called await. What it does basically is it takes a function that takes a completion handler as an argument and it turns it, and it just like it returns the value provided by the provided to the completion handler. So it does it by just using the make synchron function. Like it takes the argument, which is an asynchronous function, turns it into a synchronous function using make synchron and calls it immediately. So this is the await function when you are trying to turn a function that takes no argument into a, I don't know what I'm saying, I'm going to start it again. So this is the await implementation when you are turning a function that takes no argument, an asynchronous function that takes no argument into a synchronous function. We are going to write the same thing but for functions that do take argument, because most of the time the services that we call, they expect some kind of argument, whether it's an ID or a list or anything like that. So it's the same implementation, we use make synchron inside. So now we have this await keyword. And we're going to define another keyword which we call async. And async is just going to take a synchronous function and it's going to make it run into the queue that we created. And now that we have these two keywords, we can write this kind of code. We can write async, and then we can use await to turn asynchronous function into synchronous ones. And we can like call asynchronous functions and use them the same way that we would with normal functions. So we don't have, remember that we used to have these three services being called. We nested completion handlers into one another. Now we no longer have this nesting thing. We are calling functions sequentially like any synchronous code. So this code is much easier to maintain, because if we want to change the order, we just have to change two lines. It's easier. It's going to scale up in a much better way. So it's a much more manageable way to deal with asynchronicity. And what I want you to see is that what we did was that using the function await, we extracted the asynchronicity out of asynchronous function. And then with async, we factored it out. And we did it like in a very algebraic way, because we did it kind of the same way that we would factor a product out of a sum. So I think that's a pretty cool thing to see, that in Swift, we can write user code that lets us implement such powerful behavior. Because
there are like languages that implement async and await, but most of the time it's built into the language. You're not implementing it yourself, so it shows that Swift is a pretty nice language that gives us lots of flexibility. But I also think that I've shown you lots of content, and that it might be time to do a little recap of everything that I've shown you. I'm going to post the slide afterward if you want to go through them again, because I know that some I didn't like write everything in one go. It was months and months of experimenting. So what did we learn today? We learned that in Swift we can build. That was a typo, I think. We can build functions that enhance or alter other functions. Remember, functions take a function as a parameter and return the function. We learned that this is a great technique to reduce boilerplate, because it allows us like to add behavior to a chunks of code. We also learned that we are using functions, and functions are very composable, so it's a technique that's going to scale very well. And what's very nice is that it's going to make our code feel more declarative and reusable. Like, we no longer have to write, for instance, the implementation details of saying, I am capturing a weak self, and guarding that the instance is still in memory. We can just say, wikify this closure, and the work is done like almost by magic. And finally, we saw that it also like encourages us to look at our code in a more like algebraic way, like when we extracted and factored out the asynchronousness of a function. I'm pretty sure that there are other examples in our code where we could apply this pattern, and it would be very nice to discover them. So this is the second time that I'm giving this talk. The first time that I gave it was at the end of 2018, and it used to be the end of the talk, but this time I have one more thing, because Apple decided to release something that's called Swift 5.1. Maybe you've heard about it. And among its features, there is something that's called property wrappers. So property wrappers, like if you've read some Swift UI code, if you've attended Daniel's talk yesterday, you might have seen things like our at state of if you like, I think everybody attended Daniel's talk this morning, so at published, you've seen that too. So these things, at and then some word, it's what Swift calls a property wrapper. So it's a new edition of Swift 5.1. So at state is an example of a property wrapper that's used by Swift UI. And a property wrapper is something that's going to take a property and it's going to decorate it with a custom behavior. But the nice thing is that it's going to be completely transparent to the user. Like, you're going to use the property like any regular property, and the triggering of the custom behavior is going to be done by the compiler when it's going to compile your code. And when you think about it, it looks really close to the pseudo keywords technique I've just shown you. So I thought it made sense to say a little bit of some words about it before ending this talk. So what I want to show you is like how we can implement the debounced pseudo keyword using a property wrapper. So first thing we want to do when we want to implement a property wrapper is that we need to declare a type. So this time I'm declaring a struct called debounced. Then I'm going to add some state to this struct. So there's going to be, like before, a delay, a queue, which are going to be immutable because they're not going to change once the property wrapper has been created. And then there's going to be the action that we are actually debouncing. And in order to make the init like works well, I'm going to initialize it with the empty function because that makes sense. So like I said, the delay, the queue, and the action, that's the state. Then I'm going to create an init, so it's going to take the time interval and it's going to take the queue with a default value to the main queue. It's a regular Swift init. Yeah. And then I'm going to add this at property wrapper annotation. So this is actually what's going to turn debounced into a property wrapper. And when I add this, I'm going to get a compiler error. It's going to say you need to implement a property that's called wrapped value. So if I add it, you're not going to be able to read. So what I'm going to do is that all the part that starts with let delay up to the end of the init, I'm going to like remove it from the screen. It's still there, it's just not displayed. So now you can read. So in order to be a property wrapper, we need to implement this wrapped value property. So it's just a getter and a setter, actually. So when we are getting the value, we are just returning the action that's part of our state, pretty easy. And when we are setting the value, we are going to implement the same kind of thing that we did before. So we are going to have this work item, and then into the action, we are going to capture the queue and the delay. If the work item has already been created, we cancel it. We create a new work item and we schedule it on the queue. So it's just like before. And then when we use it, because if we don't use it, it's pointless, we're going to like create a struct that we are going to call handler, and we are going to use our property wrapper. So you see that I have this action and I'm adding at debounced, and then I'm calling the init right away. So I'm saying that I want this action to be debounced with a 1 second delay. The init is pretty standard, and this handler as a handle function is going to call the action that's part of its state. And if we use it, like if I create the handler now, I can call the function 3 times. And since the call is debounced, well, 1 second after the last call to handle, the sentence, so the content of the action, is going to be executed. So action perform is going to be printed into the console, but only once. And we've been able to, like, once again, add state to add a custom behavior to part of our code in a very declarative way. And this one, there is something that's even better, is that we've done it in a way that's officially supported and promoted by Apple. So kind of better when your code follows the community standard. So if you can implement a pseudo keyword with a property wrapper, please use this approach rather than a raw function, because it's kind of going to make your code like more time proof, I think. This time the talk is over. I think the conference is also over. So there is a slide about where to go from here. So I just wanted to tell you that I think the example shown in these slides is only the tip of the iceberg, because it's a very generic idea that I've been showing you. I think there are many more use cases that you're going to discover, like within your apps and your code base and your project, if you try to apply this technique. And if you do, please let me know, because I will be very interested. So this is my Twitter handle, and I'm going to post the slide on Twitter later. So please let me know if you find some useful use cases. Some links. So at some point I said that the code I've shown to implement caching does not work with recursive function. If for some reason you like math and recursive function, I've written an article that says how you implement this for recursive function. It's a bit more like heavier, so I'm not going to talk about it right now, but everything is explained there. If you're interested in the weak self part, because I think it's the most useful part of the talk for any project, there is like an implementation available on GitHub, and you can get it, and you will have like all the code written for functions that take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I think up to like 7 or 8 arguments. So you don't have to copy and paste it within your project, and you're good. And finally, if you like the async await ID, you can go check out this project on GitHub, which is called AwaitKit, because the code that I've shown you, in order to make it like make sense in a talk, I made some simplifications, but there is a much more full and robust implementation there. And that being said, if you have questions, I think it's time for questions. Thank you all.
Questions. While you are thinking about questions, maybe you want to plug your other Twitter activities.
Oh, yeah. We're talking about it?
Yeah.
Okay. So, a few months ago, can I go on Twitter?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I went into the office and I had this idea like, what if someone created a Twitter account to post memes about iOS development? So this is a QWERTY keyboard that I'm not familiar with.
Yeah,
can you like...
This is a German keyboard. It's a so-called Wurst keyboard.
Okay, and then memes. Yeah. So this is a meme page to check every time Xcode is indexing files. So you can see, yes, we are attending SwiftConf. And you can see some memes. I'm going to show you like the one that the community liked the most. Think it was, yeah, this one. People kind of resonated with it. The next one is going to be, I think only the older developers are going to remember things like this, like when we had static library being imported twice. It was quite something. And the last one, it's, which one is, oh yeah, of course. Dispatch queue, main async after, the ultimate bug fix. So if you like this kind of content, please follow this account.
Yeah, I think this is great. Yeah. Also, before I forget, and I have at least one question for you. Soon it will be over, but Vincent is willing to go in the city and just have some time over there. And so feel free to follow him.
Yeah.
I will be here until 5 p.m. or whatever. Feel free to stay here if you want. Feel free to empty the fridge if you want. And yeah. Now, if nobody has a question, I have one. It's about those. You have the priority.
Thank you. So, like, one of the annoying things that about doing this in Swift is, like, as you said, you have to potentially write a function REPL like 7 or 8 times because you have to know the number of arguments beforehand.
Yes.
And I know that, as far as I know, this also caused problems in Swift UI early on because they only went up to 10.
Oh, yeah.
And
okay.
Do you know if there's any more work done in the Swift language editions to kind of sort?
So, from what I know, like, projects like Eric Swift that also need this kind of thing to for like function like combine latest, etc. I think they have code generation, but yeah, they go to a finite number of arguments. I don't know if it's like a dozen or I think it's around a dozen. I would say maybe if you need more, maybe it's a sign that your code needs to be refactored. So maybe this is a good limit in a way. But otherwise, I mean, you can use code generation. You can use things like Sorcery in order to do this. I know that there is a proposal, like there is a generic manifesto in Swift, and there is a proposal in order to have like arbitrary number of generic arguments, but I haven't read it, I've only heard about it, so I can only like encourage you to go read about it, but I cannot make any insightful comment, unfortunately.
Thank you.
Okay, any other? 1, 2, 3. Any other question? Do you think those what are they called again, those at thing?
Pseudo keywords?
No. The property wrappers.
Oh.
It looks like you mentioned that it's a lot of what we will see in the future and the way it's...
It looks like, yeah, it's the direction for Swift. Property wrappers, as they say, they can only be applied to properties. We saw that So the queries were a bit more generic because we could apply it to functions and to local variables and things like that. But yeah, property wrappers are pretty cool because they are built into the system. And there is even, it's not yet implemented, but there is something in the proposal. It's that they are supposed to be composable, meaning that you can put several property wrappers together and they're going to compose just by nesting the types together. So it can give like some pretty powerful and also maybe anti-pattern behavior. But there is a lot of potential with property wrappers. Maybe we're going to like to see new things because with Swift UI, maybe the two of them are going to evolve in along the same way, I think.
Okay. Great. All right, so thank you very much. Give him a round of applause first.